Students, the chapter that we are going to do today is Introduction to Euclid Geometry. First of all, you might be wondering why this geometry is called as Euclid Geometry. We'll see to it when we'll begin the chapter. The main thing is, earlier people used to come across with problems that could be solved only by geometry. For example, when Nile River used to overflow, it used to rub all the boundaries of the surrounding fields. Then the farmers, they had a difficult task of redrawing the boundaries, and it involved the concepts of geometry. Excavations of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, that is the Indus civilization, they greatly tell the fact that this civilization was a very planned civilization. Their roads, their drainage system, everything was planned. So it was mainly dependent on this concept, that is geometry. Now let's see what we are going to look in this chapter, or what we are going to study in this chapter. First of all, we'll see the basic terms or the basic definition that we are going to deal in this chapter, right? Then we'll take a look at Euclid's axioms and Euclid's postulates. We'll learn about what is the difference between an axiom and a postulate, right? Then there was a main or the key point in Euclid's postulate, that was the fifth postulate. We'll learn about the equivalent version of this postulate, right? So let's start with the chapter. Now, first of all, starting with the chapter, geometry. Geometry comes from two Greek words, that is geo and metrin, right? The words are Greek. Both of them are Greek words. Greek words, right? Geo and metrin. Now, geo means in Greek earth, right? And metrin means measure. So, geometry means measurement of earth. It basically means measurement of earth. Now you might be wondering, why is the topic named as measurement of earth? Because as I already told you earlier, the people used to have problems related to things that they had to measure the fields, they had to measure the plots. So every problem was related to land or the earth. That's why this topic was named as measurement of earth or geometry, right? Now what was going on earlier is that Babylonians and Egyptians, they were more focused on the practical aspects of geometry. And each and every part of the universe, geometry was getting developed and it was getting applied, right? But the Greeks, they were more focused on the theoretical part or the reasoning part of the geometry. Now there was a teacher who was teaching the students at Alexandria. His name was Euclid. Now what Euclid did is, he collected all the works that was going around the world and he presented it in his book. That was called Elements. The name of the book was It had 13 chapters, or there were 13 parts to this book, in which he explained all the concepts of geometry that were going on around that point of time in the world, right? So there were some basic definitions with which he started off the concept of geometry. Those definitions were, first, the definition of solid. Now what is a solid? According to Euclid, solid is anything that has shape, size and position, right? Anything which is having a shape, a well-defined shape, it is having a well-defined size and a well-defined position is called a solid. Now, the solid has this property that it can move from one point to another point. This was the definition of solid in Euclid's geometry. Because we are going to deal with the version of Euclid, how he developed geometry, that's why we'll call this chapter as Euclid's geometry, right? Next, he defined surface. Now what is called as surface? Surface is nothing but when we have a solid. When we have a solid, if we take boundary of a solid, right? The boundary of a solid is called as a surface, right? Now then he defined curves and straight line as boundaries of these surfaces are called as curves or straight lines. For example, if I intersect a solid with a plane surface, right, then I get a straight line, right? Now these definition, the definition of solid, the definition of surface, the definition of straight line, these definitions provided by Euclid, they were a bit complicated because the words that the definitions were using, they itself have to be defined, right? So we won't use these definitions, but the assumptions that were made by Euclid, they were very important to us. Now what he did was he assumed some things which later came out to be as universal truths. Now his assumptions, some of his assumptions are known as axioms and some of his assumptions are known as postulates. Now what is the difference between axioms and postulates? Axioms are the assumptions that apply to general mathematics, right? They apply to general mathematics, but postulates, they are specific to geometry. So postulates are nothing but the assumptions that are specific to geometry. Specific to geometry, right? These were general and these were specific to geometry, right? Now let's look at some of the axioms that were provided by Euclid, right? Now the first axiom says, things which are equal to the same thing are equal to one another. Things which are equal to the same thing are equal to one another. Let's take an example for this. Suppose I have a rectangle and I have a triangle and I have a square. This is a square. This is a triangle and this is a rectangle, right? Now by the first axiom, it means to say that if the area of rectangle is equal to area of triangle, if the area, I'll represent area by AR, area of rectangle is equal to area of triangle and one more condition is given to us, area of triangle is equal to area of square. Now we have a certain rectangle with some dimensions, we have a triangle with some dimensions and a square with some dimensions. Now what is happening is the area of rectangle and triangle, they are equal to each other, right? And the area of triangle and square, they are equal to each other, right? So this statement, by this axiom, this says that the area of rectangle and square would be equal to each other as well. It is going to be equal to each other as well. This simply basically means if A is equal to B and B is equal to some other C, then A definitely will be equal to C, right? Rectangle was equal to triangle, triangle was equal to square, so rectangle is definitely equal to square. This was the first axiom, that things which are equal to the same thing are equal to one another, right? Now the axioms and postulates that we are going to do, or the whole chapter, you will see that this is nothing but a very basic concept. We are going to learn all the basic concepts, nothing new you are going to study in this chapter. But the thing is, we have to study this chapter as the way it was developed by Euclid, right? So we'll try to prove, or we'll try to do questions in the form that we know only this information and we don't know anything else. That is the basic problem that students face in this chapter, that the questions, they are really, really simple, but they don't know how to solve it or how to start writing it. So for this, I would recommend, just think in your mind that you know only these things, these axioms and these postulates, and rest you know nothing. Then you will be able to solve the questions very easily, right? Now the next statement says, if equals are added to equals, the wholes are equals, right? So this is a very simple statement. Again, this statement says, if x is equal to y, right? Or let's say, if x is equal to 2 and y is equal to 3. So x is equal to 2 and y is equal to 3. Right, then x plus y would be equal to 2 plus 3, that is equal to 5. So this statement says, if equals are added to equals, the wholes are equals. X was equal to 2 and y was equal to 3, so when they both were added, the whole, that is nothing but x plus y, that is equal to the whole, that is nothing but 2 plus 3, right? So the whole x plus y is equal to the whole 5, right? Now the next statement is very similar to this one. If equals are subtracted from equals, the remainders are also equal. Now this statement was based on addition. The next statement simply says if equals are subtracted from equals, then the remainders, they are also equal. Now the fourth statement or the fourth axiom, this says things which coincide with one another are equal to one another. Now what do we mean by coincide? By coincide we mean things which are similar to each other, or which are not similar but which are identical to each other, they are equal to each other, right? For example, I have a, let's say, a triangle A, B, C, and I have another triangle D, E, F, right? So if I cut a paper, if I draw a triangle D, E, F on it, and if I cut a paper and trace this triangle on triangle ABC, what I see is DEF superimposes on ABC. What do I mean by superimpose? The D vertex, it coincides with A vertex, E coincides with B, and F coincides with C. So, right? So, I can say that this triangle is identical to this triangle. So, what do I mean by this is they are equal to each other, or basically their areas are equal to each other, their perimeters are equal to each other. Every property that is defined on a triangle, it is equal for both the triangles, right? Now let's look at the next axiom. The next axiom is very simple. It says the whole is greater than the part, right? The whole is greater than the part. Now this is a very general statement. You must be agreeing with this. Let's say I have z equals x plus y. I have z equal to x plus y. Now z is nothing but this is the whole or the combination of the parts. These two are nothing but they are parts, right? So if z is equal to x plus y, then I can definitely say that z is greater than x. Now z is the whole and x is the part, so z is definitely greater than x, and z is definitely greater than y. So whole will always be greater than the parts, right? Now things which are double of the same things are equal to one another. Now this is also a very general statement. Let's say I have x equals y. I have x equals y. Now what will be the double of x? Double of x would be 2x. And what would be double of y? Double of y would be 2y, right? So this statement says that things which are double of the same things are equal to one another. So x and y both are same because they are equal, right? So their double would be also equal. So this statement says if x equals y, then 2x equals 2y, right? Now what does the axiom, next axiom says? It says things which are halves of the same thing are equal to one another. Now in this case we came from this to this, right? But in the next axiom we'll go from this to this. We are given, this is given to us, now this is given to us, and we have to prove this one. In contrary to the previous question, 2x equals 2y, this is given to us. Now the half of 2x would be x and the half of 2y would be y. So we can easily say if 2x equals 2y, then the halves would also be equal to one another, right? So these were all the axioms that were given by Euclid, right? Now let's look at some of the postulates. The postulates that were given by Euclid, they were very, very important. You might say that the axioms and postulates, they are very basic, but these axioms and postulates when combined, they are going to be used to help us solve the question, right? Now the first postulate says a straight line may be drawn from any point to any other point. Suppose we have two points, let's say we have a point A and we have a point B. Now we have two points A and B. This postulate says that a straight line may be drawn from A and ending at B, right? So if we have two points, I can definitely draw a straight line that will pass through both the points, right? Now Euclid, he assumed the uniqueness of this line or uniqueness of this AB. He never said that we'll have only one line that will pass through A and B, right? If we try to draw another line that passes through A and B, we won't get any such line, right? He assumed the uniqueness of this line. This line AB is unique. There is no other line which can pass through A and B both, right? So this was not included in his postulate, but as this was his assumption, so in his books this was mentioned as an axiom, right? So let's take a look at the next postulate. A terminated line can be produced indefinitely. Now what do we mean by a terminated line? Now what is a line? First of all, a line is something, a two-dimensional figure which extends on both the sides, right? A line is something which extends on both the side, right? This arrow and this arrow means they extend on both the sides. This is a line, right? Now a terminated line, by a terminated line we mean a line which has two fixed points. Terminated line means line having fixed points. Now in other chapters you'll come across the definition of terminated line as a line segment or maybe a ray, depending on whether it is terminated from both the sides or only from one side. But in this chapter, it is just called a terminated line. That is a line having two fixed points, A or B. Line having two fixed points, or we can say end points, right? Now, this postulate says a terminated line can be produced indefinitely. Now, this is nothing but this is a part of line. We can produce this line segment or this terminated line on both the sides. If we want to produce from B, we can produce it indefinitely, that is, it can extend up to infinity. And from A, if we want to produce it, we can produce it indefinitely in this direction. So a terminated line can be produced indefinitely in both the directions, right? Now the next postulate that we have is a circle can be drawn with any center and any radius, right? Now to draw a circle, we need only two parameters, right? We need the radius of the circle, and to define the position of the circle, we need the center of the circle. So if you are given the center and the radius, a circle can easily be drawn. So this was the third postulate of Euclid, right? Now the fourth postulate says all right angles are equal to one another. Now what is a right angle? We all know what is a right angle. Angle which is equal to 90 degrees. Suppose we have a triangle ABC and angle B is equal to 90 degrees. So I can say that angle ABC is a right angle. Angle ABC is a right angle, right? So this says if we have two right angles, suppose I have a right angle in triangle ABC and I have another right angle in say D, E, F. Angle E is also right angle, so I can definitely say that angle ABC is equal to right angle, that is 90 degree, and angle DEF is also equal to 90 degree. So I can definitely say that angle ABC is equal to angle DEF, right? Because things which are equal to the same things are equal to one another, which was provided in the axiom.